5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Ignition. Liftoff of the Falcon 9 and Crew Dragon. Go NASA. Go SpaceX. Godspeed, Bob and Doug.
In May, millions tuned in to watch NASA and SpaceX make history.
So rises a new era of American spaceflight, and with it the ambitions of a new generation continuing the dream.
The launch of SpaceX's Crew Dragon capsule to the International Space Station marked the first time that NASA astronauts took off from U.S. soil since 2011. The event also represented the first time a commercially designed and built spacecraft carried astronauts, an achievement that SpaceX and Boeing had vied for years under NASA's Commercial Crew Program. The program was structured as a multi-tiered competition. The goal was to get private sector companies to produce the most cost-effective, innovative, and safe way to get astronauts to the International Space Station, under specific parameters set forth by NASA. In the end, SpaceX and Boeing beat out Sierra Nevada Corporation for the job.
The traditional aerospace industry, of course, questioned startup companies like SpaceX. A very senior executive, one of the competitors, told me that SpaceX will never fly. Their rockets are put together with sealing wax and chewing gum. We really had a very healthy competition.
For nearly a decade, SpaceX and Boeing have been neck and neck, building and testing their crew transportation systems. But SpaceX's successful launch in May marked a major milestone for the company, leaving Boeing to play catch-up. The launch on May 30th is technically the last test flight before NASA can certify Crew Dragon for consistent operational missions to the space station. The test is scheduled to end on August 2nd, with the return of NASA's astronauts to Earth. On the other hand, Boeing has yet to complete a successful uncrewed test flight after it encountered some issues last year.
I'm really quite overcome with emotion on this day. It's kind of hard to talk, frankly. It's been 18 years working towards this goal, so it's hard to believe that it's happened.
The Commercial Crew Program was born out of a prior initiative called the Commercial Orbital Transportation Services Program, or known more affectionately within NASA as COTS. COTS began in about the mid-2000s, and it was simply a push to see if private companies could develop spacecraft and deliver cargo to the International Space Station.
Two commercial partners were tapped for the job, SpaceX and Orbital ATK, a company now owned by Northrop Grumman. COTS was a success and gave NASA the confidence that it needed to expand the commercial partnerships beyond ferrying cargo to ferrying astronauts. This became a particularly pressing need after NASA ended the shuttle program in 2011.
The program was initiated in order to reduce the cost of spaceflight and to make it more routine. And it was not doing that for the first couple of years, only reaching 4 or 5 flights a year at a huge overhead of $3 to $4 billion.
The shuttle program also suffered 2 tragic accidents. The first in 1986, when the Challenger exploded just over a minute into its flight, killing all 7 crew members.
From mission control, silence. Then the bland, chilling report.
We have a report from the flight dynamics officer that the vehicle has exploded. Flight director confirms that. We are looking at checking with the recovery forces to see what can be done at this point.
The second in 2003, when the shuttle Columbia broke apart upon re-entry into Earth's atmosphere, once again killing all 7 astronauts on board.
After the shuttle program ended, you essentially had a gap in the U.S. capability to launch its own astronauts. And the only other entity in the world that had an operating spacecraft capable of doing that was Russia. Their Soyuz spacecraft became the cornerstone of our ability to launch astronauts to the International Space Station.
And it was becoming an increasingly expensive service.
Originally, those seats were around $20 million per seat, and now we're paying over $90 million per seat. So over the last 9 years, it has gotten very, very expensive. And we're in a position now to say, look, we want to continue the partnership on the International Space Station, but what we don't want to have is dependency. And so what Commercial Crew gives us is an opportunity to end the dependency and continue the partnership on the International Space Station.
Under NASA's Commercial Crew Program, companies bid for a fixed-price contract to build a vehicle to fly astronauts to and from the space station. Boeing and SpaceX won and were awarded $4.2 billion and $2.6 billion, respectively. This type of contract requires the companies to cover any additional costs they incur during development. But it also means that the companies retain their rights to all of their intellectual property, and are therefore free to use it as they please after their NASA contract ends.
Think of it like a space Uber or a space taxi. The idea being, we're gonna buy services, but we expect those launch providers to go get customers that are not NASA, which drives down our costs. And we expect those launch providers to compete against each other on cost and innovation and safety.
We did not want to have just one bidder for a number of reasons. We know that competition really drives innovation, and one could also have a problem and you don't want to leave yourself with just one source like we have throughout NASA's history. So this is a way to make the program more robust.
Though SpaceX and Boeing both got the job, the race was on to see who could put astronauts on the space station first. SpaceX used the money to develop the Crew Dragon capsule, and Boeing used it to develop the Starliner capsule. Both capsules are designed to be reusable, with SpaceX even recycling its rocket, the Falcon 9, which it uses to launch Crew Dragon. A report issued last year by NASA's Office of Inspector General found that NASA expects to pay SpaceX an average of about $55 million per seat, and Boeing about $90 million per seat for the 6 round-trip missions to the ISS. But Boeing and NASA both refuted the OIG numbers. In a statement, Boeing said that the company will fly the equivalent of a fifth passenger in cargo for NASA, so the per-seat pricing should be considered based on 5 seats rather than the report's 4-seat calculation. Christina Chaplin is a former director at the Government Accountability Office and was in charge of auditing the Commercial Crew Program for Congress.
Boeing had the advantage of having a long history of working with NASA, a long history with the shuttle program, and, you know, knowing how to do these kinds of spacecraft. SpaceX was new to the game, and I think their advantage was their flexibility, their speed, their culture, that they could work in this fixed price, more commercial-like environment.
SpaceX also had the advantage of being able to apply a lot of what it learned from building its cargo capsule for NASA's COTS program to its crew capsule. By the time it received its crew program contract from NASA in 2014, SpaceX had been ferrying cargo to the space station for 2 years. The Commercial Crew Program was initially slated to launch astronauts to the International Space Station in 2017, but early funding cuts and a number of failed tests made that impossible. One such setback for SpaceX happened in 2019, when its Crew Dragon capsule blew up during a test of the in-flight abort system. SpaceX had also previously lost 2 Falcon 9 rockets, one during a space station resupply mission in 2015.
Stunning explosion over the skies of Cape Canaveral today, an unmanned rocket bringing supplies to the International Space Station blew up just 2 minutes into its flight. It's another setback for NASA and for SpaceX, the company that will one day carry astronauts into orbit.
And another in 2016 that was supposed to launch Facebook's $200 million satellite into orbit. Boeing also struggled. In 2018, a propellant leak was found in the engine of the Starliner capsule during a launch abort test. Then in 2019, the company hit a major speed bump with its orbital flight test, an important milestone to safely carry astronauts.
It didn't have any people on board, but what it was supposed to do was launch, get to the space station, spend a few days there, and then come back. Well, shortly after launching, they discovered an anomaly with part of the timing system inside the spacecraft itself, and the engines fired at the wrong time, putting it in the wrong orbit. So they weren't able to reach the International Space Station, falling short of the main priority of the flight test.
The incident changed how NASA viewed Boeing. The agency even admitted that their prior history with Boeing may have led them to give the company more leeway in terms of oversight.
I would say in the software area, from a NASA perspective, we may have been focused a little more on SpaceX because they use a bit of a non-traditional approach to their software development. We had maybe more familiarity with the Boeing process from those that had worked on the International Space Station. Many of the team that did the software for International Space Station was actually working on the Starliner, and so we just didn't quite take the time that we needed to.
NASA is now recommending that Boeing make 80 changes to the Starliner before it's retested later this year.
Just in general, the government is kind of waking up across the space sector in terms of software. It's very tricky. And the government's not very successful in doing software for space at this time.
SpaceX is in a really strong position to deliver for NASA. They have a much faster timeline. I think that they stick to reiterating on their technology because Elon Musk came from the software side, right? So Elon Musk, he was one of the founders of PayPal. He's had Tesla. He's had experience working in different industries where he's not used to sitting, waiting around for, you know, the federal government budget, thinking about milestones that could be impacted just based off of politics.
Though commercial crew missions have not yet started, NASA, SpaceX, and Boeing are already seeing the benefits of such partnerships.
NASA estimates that this process saved the agency somewhere between $20 billion and $30 billion of taxpayer money because the method of contracting and the efficiency of the companies to meet the milestones that they were setting out to achieve was so much more efficient than historically possible.
While NASA benefits from lower costs, SpaceX and Boeing benefit from having a government agency foot the bill for the building and development of systems that they can use for other projects.
There was a day in the United States of America after the space shuttles retired where we had exactly 0% of the global launch for commercial satellites. And of course, because NASA made these investments into SpaceX and the Falcon 9 rocket, now all of a sudden we've got about 70% of the global commercial launch market.
If you look at SpaceX's revenue on the whole, NASA makes up a significant portion of that because of the development contracts they have awarded the company over the years. While the bread and butter of their business is their launch business, launching satellites for companies, for the US military and others, this is a very large chunk to the tune of hundreds of millions of dollars a year that comes from NASA.
But SpaceX is looking to expand. The company has already signed a contract to fly three tourists to the International Space Station using its Crew Dragon capsule and Falcon 9 rocket. Space currently makes up only about 5% of Boeing's revenue. But with the company losing billions due to the grounding of its 737 MAX plane and its stock price plunging due to the lackluster travel demand among coronavirus, that could change.
There's going to be a lot more incentive for Boeing to really deliver for NASA. In the past, if you think about what is the biggest revenue generator for Boeing, I would doubt that NASA provides a huge, huge contribution to their top line. But now, as they ground more of the aircrafts and they have to rethink their approach to the whole airline industry, space is definitely a bigger opportunity for them.
And the opportunities to work with NASA will certainly continue.
Right now in space, we've got commercial resupply. We've got commercial crew now. And eventually, we're going to have commercial space stations themselves. We want to be one customer of many customers, and we want our providers competing on cost and innovation and safety.
NASA is already partnering with the private sector for another venture, getting people to the moon by 2024. In April, the agency awarded contracts to SpaceX, Blue Origin, and Dynetics to begin development of lunar landers. Boeing also bid, but was not awarded a contract.
We're going to blaze the trail, always with the intent to eventually commercialize as quickly as possible. Once that's done at the moon, then we go to Mars.